Hey there YouTube, Engineering is Magic, back again with another video, and I am kicking off Computer Science for Stoners. And this is going to be a whole series about computers, computing, how you are a computer, how computers rule your life, how to make computers, and how to make computers do what you want. So here I am at the Computer History Museum. You can see it's a pretty cool architecture, and we're going to be going through some of the exhibits, and I'll be giving a little guided tour. And really, we're going to start off with some of the basics, you know, the first 2,000 years of computing. But really, I think of us as computers. What you are is a computer. You're a feedback machine. You're using sensory input from your eyes, your body, your senses, sights, and smells. And then you're, you know, making judgments on that. You're comparing things. You're recognizing objects. You know, just because your eye can see light in a tree, in the form of a tree, it's really your mind that's computing that that is a tree. And that other trees, even though they don't look exactly the same, you know what the abstract concept of a tree is. Your mind is a comparator, a giant feedback computer that is learning all the time, just like the frickin' Terminator. But a lot of us don't understand or think about things really in that way. Really, we think of computers as this high-tech, esoteric thing. You know, they're new, they're fancy, they're completely understandable. Just, you know, magical even to the people that can make them do things. But really, you already have all the knowledge you need to understand computers and computing and everything that's going on in the world. And that's why this is Computer Science for Stoners. You already know everything you need to become a computer science expert, people. And I'm going to prove it. So let's talk about the basics of computing. So computing is easy as 1, 2, 3. Let's start with adding. Adding is one of the most basic things that we do as humans. You know, when we look at something, we inherently group things in orders of how many there are. Is there one of something? 2, 3, 10. And then we apply judgments to that. Maybe looking at a fruit tree, there's 10 apples on that tree, so we're going to head toward that tree rather than the apple tree that only has 3 apples on it. Maybe there's 10 people who are warriors and you're wondering how you're going to attack them. There's so many ways that adding and keeping track of numbers is definitely a mental capability that humans have had for a long time. But we don't really have a great ability to keep in track huge amounts of numbers. Really, we think of things in terms of 1, 2, 3 to kind of 6, and then there's kind of 10 to 50, and then there's just a bunch. You know, pretty much anything over 10, people just look at it and say there's just a bunch there. If you had 5, they would tell you that it's 5. Like looking at this many calculators, you can say that there's 4 calculators. But if I just pull back, how many calculators are there? You just say there's a bunch. You probably don't say that there's like 9 or 10. So calculators are one of the first things that we started doing in order to be able to keep track of large numbers and manipulate large numbers, because we're really not very good at remembering numbers for long periods of time. And if you want to keep track of, say, how much grain you have in the granary, or what interest is on a bank account, or how many bushels of rice you harvested last month, you need to keep track of these numbers for longer periods of time. So you have techniques like writing. You have tools like the abacus here, which you can basically move small things around back and forth, and it doesn't require any extra mental capability to do complicated math. You just move them back and forth. As you move the top row up and down, it's numbers of 5, and then the bottom 4 will go up and down. So what you're doing here is you're basically encoding numbers in positions on the abacus. So encoding, being able to take an object that we understand like a number and then making it into another abstract concept, is one of the basics of computing, because numbers don't really have form. So we have to give them form, and the form that we give them, we want it to be able to be easily worked on. We want to be able to do addition easily. We want it to be remembered easily. We use computing and technology to make our lives easier and more powerful, and for us to do more things by ourselves. That's the whole purpose of computing, and that is how we became computers, because as we lived and evolved, our computing mentality, our ability to analyze complex problems and break them down, is what really differentiated us from other animals. So you can just see all of these different mechanical adding machines here. One of the definite examples of using objects to calculate numbers is definitely a slide rule here. You can see by moving the different rails around, you can calculate numbers and logarithms. And this is all mechanical, you know, this is basically using things like gears, buttons, wooden objects, and moving them back and forth, usually using human power, not electricity, not animal power, or anything like that. So this is really the definite basics of computing here. But you don't really think of it as computing, just as you probably don't think of your brain as actually computing anything, although it does all the time. So kind of like an abacus is one way to represent numbers, punch cards, these things in front of us up here, are the basic floppy disk, which was before, you know, we usually used flash drives. So this is a way of encoding a program. You basically punch holes where you need to. This is a Japanese punch card, obviously. And then the computer will read the holes in the card and do different things based on that. So, but a lot of these machines are big just because that's what the technology was, and the punch cards are big. So if the format of the card is big, then the machine has to be big. Everything around it has to be big. So that's why these things are just so big. These things are like the size of small pianos. So here we go with one of the first electrical machines that did not use switches and relays, but actually used electrical signals, which are analog signals, before digital computing, to actually do things like draw pictures and compute trajectories of artillery and other armaments. That's typically what computers did back in the day. What you would do is, with artillery, over long distances, if you're shooting north or south, depending on which hemisphere you're in, you have to adjust your trajectory for different effects, including gravity, tilt, windage, and other things. So what you would do is you would get a computer like this, and it would make an entire book of artillery values that would get published by, like, the army and sent out to all the soldiers that they could reference and use. But this is complex stuff. I mean, if you were doing this by hand, it would be error-prone, and it would take a long time for a lot of people. So this is one of the first fully electric computers that doesn't have a lot of mechanics behind it. And on the other side, we have one of the first digital computers, which is the ENIAC. You can see down here it says the original ENIAC. So this was also done by the Army to do ballistic trajectories, and this uses vacuum tubes. You can actually see them inside there instead of analog signals. And basically, the vacuum tubes are the old version of a transistor. And you might know what a transistor is, you might not, I'll get into that later. But basically, you can use vacuum tubes to amplify signals, and you can also use them to switch signals without having any mechanical failure in there. So that means, without any mechanics like a switch or a read that goes back and forth, now you can operate faster because there's no mechanical movement. And that also means that the computer can operate a lot more reliably. So here you can see the programming panel, where you can basically change all of these magical knobs that have huge manuals behind them to make it do different things. This is the programming. And this was actually one of the first roles that women were doing a lot of, which is programmers. That is what typically meant when the women would come in and change all the knobs to make the machine calculate different trajectories or different positions. And that was one of the first roles of women in computing, and it's kind of been a little bit hidden by history. You know, you mostly think of it as a male science, but, you know, during the periods of World War II and in the Army, a lot of men were in the Army, so the women were available to do things like research at the Army. So as you can see here, one of these computers from the 50s that are still using vacuum tubes, basically, the computer is huge because all the parts inside of it are huge. What you need to do for the logic is to make it all smaller. Now, you know, we would think, oh, personal computers are so small. But that's because all the parts inside of them are small. And the vacuum tube actually has to be a certain size because of the physics behind how they work. There has to be a certain separation between the parts inside, and they have to maintain a vacuum. So that allows for the vacuum tubes to operate properly. So if a vacuum tube becomes broken, you know, like it overheats, or it melts, or the glass cracks, or the vacuum seal is broken, then you have to replace that tube, and of course it doesn't tell you which tube is broken. As you can also see, that computers are going to be getting smaller, much smaller, and we'll be talking about how the different processes get us down to a computer where we can actually recognize that's a computer. So if you've ever watched Top Gun, you kind of know what one of these is, right? It's a fire control system from a ship, and basically what you can do is you can use this light gun, kind of like the Nintendo, you know, Duck Hunt gun, and you can touch it on the screen, and it'll figure out where you're pointing, and then you can basically determine what weapons you want to use, how you want to direct fire, and then direct that fire towards your targets, and it will incorporate things like radar. So why is this important? Other than the fact that the Army is constantly pushing the bounds of technology, it's because you want to get an advantage over the other side, even though you have the same number of people and the same resources, right? Technology is one of those things that's a force multiplier. Someone with technology is many more times more effective than someone without. Just like a gun for soldiers is definitely a force multiplier. Computing is definitely a force multiplier. Understanding technology, knowing how to make it work for you, and make it do the things you want to do, is going to make you a lot more powerful, and that's what it's all about. Again, the military, using things like bombs and planes, can do, with 10 people on a plane, more than a whole regiment could do on the ground. Thousands and thousands of people on the ground could not do the same technical devastation with the speed and accuracy that could be afforded by modern technology. And without things to direct the fire, direct the bombs, be able to navigate properly, all of the things that go on in the background, that technology would not exist. That's why it's all powerful. It all builds on itself. So what we need to do is remember that. Keep using the technology that we have in order to get places that we haven't been yet. So look at some of this. This is the inside of a guided missile. So what we're using now is technology to go places that we couldn't have ever gone before. We're doing things like keeping track of radar, keeping track of our internal position, what our roll pitch is, directing different thrust power to different areas of the missile to guide it toward a location. We need to know where that is. It's pretty amazing. And eventually, we went to the moon. That's what we did with this technology. We took a couple hundred people, and we did what we couldn't do with everybody building ladders could do in a whole life, millions of years. You know, it's just not going to happen. So technology gives us the ability to do things that we've never thought possible before. And really, while a lot of people will think, oh, that's just not possible, and give it up there, it's those people that work on technology that can take a problem, break it down into parts that we can do, and then actually solve it. And that's what's awesome. So up until now, most computer systems have been made to do one specific thing. An abacus can only add and operate on numbers. You know, you can do subtraction, maybe some multiplication and division, but you can't guide a missile to the moon. What we're talking about now is general computing, personal computing. So what you can do is write programs which are independent of the computer and the powerful processors that it runs, and then what you can do is make it do anything you want. Here's a map of all the different programming languages that have come about, which are basically different ways to generally describe an algorithm, which is how to operate on the sensors, on the inputs of the computer, and then how to make it do something. So obviously the inputs and the outputs are things like peripherals, things like monitors, keyboards, mice, sensors, radar, etc. But as you can see, as time goes on, we keep coming up with different ways to describe programs, just like different normal languages have been described to make ideas. But it's also a lot more evolutionary than that. Because as we gain more knowledge and gain power to be able to compute more complex languages more quickly, we're going to make more complex programs in complex languages that will handle things that we didn't think of or couldn't handle before. So now that we've got general computing and the ability to make complicated programs, we really need to up the horsepower of this computer. This is a Cray 1 supercomputer. This uses 115 kilowatts of power, and basically, it is stuffed to the gills with wires and processors. Down here, you can see all the power regulators that it needs in order to generate enough electricity and to keep it cool enough so that it doesn't set itself on fire. All the wires in there are kept under 3 feet, I think, because even electricity can't go faster than the speed of light, and therefore, if you can keep all the wires really short in there for some of these big machines, you're going to be able to make it run faster, do more, and operate more powerfully. But even so, this is taking a lot of effort, and the more power you put in here, like 115 kilowatts, the more you're going to waste in the transforming the power, and the more you're going to waste in having to cool the thing. So now that we have computers that can do what we need, languages that can express how we want to do it, and all the technology to do it, we just need the will in order to do it. But we don't need all that computing power for normal personal users, and while major companies didn't think that it was a good idea to build small personal computers and have them on all the desks, they would rather you buy a large, like, Cray supercomputer and then have a bunch of terminals to interface with that. Now we have the Apple computer. Here we have one of the first Apple computers, the Apple One, and you can see the layout is very nice, and we're using a lot of integrated circuit technology. You can see it's just using a lot of these small chips. These little black things are integrated circuits, and they all do different things inside of the PC, obviously, and the board hooks up all the pins, basically all the little metal connectors, to each other in order to make it work in a logical way. Then you have the ability to load programs from things like a disk drive or a serial port or a cassette drive, and it can run its own programs. So this is very cheap. You know, like, the parts are small because they're all IC semiconductors. They're all very cheap, and because they're small and cheap, they don't take a lot of power. And because they don't take a lot of power, they don't generate a lot of heat that you need to dissipate. So you can make computers a lot smaller, and as you make one part smaller, other parts can become smaller, and then other parts can become smaller, and then you get a whole field of personal computers. Basically, the 80s was just ripe with it. People were building their own. You could build them from kits. You could do whatever you wanted, because you could buy these parts off the shelf and put them together yourself. Now, this was a little bit early for the PC revolution, but we are getting there. And then there's PCs you can buy from other companies. Companies like Atari, Commodore, and Apple are releasing PCs that you can buy in your house. I actually had an Atari 800. It was one of the first computers that I had as a kid. But now, this really basic computing for things like spreadsheets, math, games, can be available for everybody to use by themselves without the cost or power requirements of a large supercomputer that a company would have to have. So even a small company could use one computer for all of their bookkeeping and, you know, payroll perhaps, and everything else, and that can only cost a couple $1,000s. So that's a really good deal for people. And this is how everybody started to get PCs. But what do you do now if you have all these personal computers and you want to make a supercomputer out of them? Now, while it's not nearly as efficient, what you can do is you can take all the small computers and make a computing cluster out of them. Now, this is one of the early Beowulf clusters from NASA, and basically it's just a bunch of machines. They all have small disks in them. They can boot up, they pull their like OS from the network. They communicate with each other to operate on tasks in parallel. So this is exactly what things like SETI at home are still doing today. And for protein folding, looking for extraterrestrial intelligence, basically hooking up the computing resources of a lot of machines, figuring out ways to do algorithms, you know, in parallel. So with SETI at home, what they do is they take the telescope data and then they break it down into chunks which can be independently worked on. Now, while before you might not have thought about that, you might have built a general supercomputer for that and like have a Cray processing it, you're like, wow, I can break up the input data into different chunks and then have it operate on much more cheaply than I would be able to do normally. Now, Google, when they have their search engines and a lot of other database things, they have a whole bunch of PCs with a whole bunch of disk drives together that you can buy off the shelf because they're so much cheaper than having to buy expensive supercomputing equipment from one of the leading supercomputing manufacturers that don't do nearly the volume to reduce the cost. So that's why computing clusters like this one, tucked in the back here, one of the first Beowulf clusters, is definitely important. So another important part about computing is definitely communications, the ability to take the knowledge you found out or computed and transmit it to other people who can use that knowledge. So let's talk about some early forms of communication, like the telegraph. We're using encoding, again, ways to take the data and put it in a way that we can use the technology to transmit it, like Morse code, and then transmitting it over wires. You know, we're using the technology of electricity and closing the circuit in order to make noises and signals on the line to transmit the data. Now this is really kind of primitive, but it's really the basics of the internet in its formative ways. You have Morse code, which is the ability to encode data into a way that you can use it on the telegraph. Now there's one major means of communication in the world right now, and it's definitely the internet. And the internet is great because it doesn't rely at all on how what kind of data you're sending over it or how it's formatted, just as long as it is addressable, as long as it can deliver it. So imagine now you're sending yourself a letter through the post office. The post office doesn't need to know what's inside the letter or box, but it does need to know the address. Then, once you actually get the letter, you need to know how to open it and how to read it. It has to be in a language that you understand. If you got a letter in French, you wouldn't be able to understand it unless you read French. So, just like that, computers need to know what kind of language it is, what kind of protocol it is, right? Is it HTTP? Is it a web page? Is it FTP? Are you transferring a file? And it needs to know that context of the communication in order to do the right thing and to process it in the right way. But because we're all using the same internet, and the internet itself is routable, it's kind of like the global post office of digital awesomeness, where it's everything is delivered almost instantaneously, everything is forwarded to the right place. So, but again, the use and the point of the ARPANET, which is the basic predecessor to the internet, was defense. We wanted to be able to send messages and keep military command and control in the event of a nuclear emergency, where places like Washington, New York, Chicago, LA were taken out, major facilities were cut, but we would have a completely independent backup system of communications in case of that emergency that we would be able to control and do command and control operations to fight back against that war. But basically, once the ARPANET grew past the university level and became the internet, and it was globally routable, that's when it really kicked off and became super awesome. So as you can see with this shirt, there's a lot of different protocols, different ways you can send messages over the internet. And Cisco, a major brand of routers, basically what they do is they are the post office workers in that they are the people that actually look at the addresses on the envelopes and then forward them on to the right person that the envelope was addressed to. So why is computing just so damn important? Basically, computing is not just a way that we can interact with the world or build tools, but it's a way that we can analyze our own life, our own thinking processes, our own algorithms, our ways of dealing with things, and we can update them. We can rewrite our own software, our own ways of doing things, and make them better. We can use the technology that we know, the knowledge that we know, to make ourselves stronger, to be able to do more with the knowledge that we have in order to be more powerful and affect more change in the world. And that is what it's all about, because basically, when you're a minority, you're not really that powerful alone. You need to work with other people, and all of those people need to work to increase their strength through community action, through self-learning, and through direct action against the people that are causing you harm. But really, computing and engineering is a way of life. So peace out, everybody.